Welcome to EPG Pathshala. Today we are going to do a module on liberal feminism as part of the course on gender and social work. I am Dr. Shuli Kumar, Associate Professor in School of Social Work, Tata Institute of Social Sciences. The topics that we are going to look at in this particular module are beginning of liberal feminist approach, basics of liberal feminism, basic ideas of liberal feminism, two types of liberal feminism, a critique of liberal feminism, and finally a summary of the entire theoretical framework of liberal feminism. Let's look at the beginnings of liberal feminism, which has a very old history. The roots of liberal feminism theory were laid by Mary Wollstonecraft, who wrote The Vindication of Rights of Women when the economic social position of European women were on decline. This was in response to the rapid industrialization that was happening in the modern Western world. And with industrialization came this whole problem of women being pushed into the families and men going outside the family to work in different industrial conditions, factories and workplaces. Till 18th century, productive work, that is the work that is that used to generate an income or product for a family to live on, had been done in and around the family home, both by women and men. So therefore, most of the work was equally distributed among women and men, and the work that women did was given a high status because it made sure that the family was well looked after, and there was not so much of a division in terms of productive and reproductive work. But when the forces of industrial capitalism began to draw labor out of the private home and into the public space, that is the time when gradually the sexual division of labor started taking over. And as industrialization moved slowly and unevenly, the strongest impact was on married and bourgeois women, who were in fact able to suddenly realize that while they were doing household work, they also had plenty of free time at home, and they were essentially not doing anything outside. They were confined within the household. Yet they also had, since the industrial capitalism brought about prosperity for some, especially those who had the control over means of production, the women within these households found plenty of time to sit at home and hire also various hired help from the societies or workers who were not so well off. So the women who belonged to lower socioeconomic strata were the ones who provided help for the household work. So as a result, the bourgeois women didn't have too many things to do either at home, nor were they doing anything productive work outside. So according to Mary Wollstonecraft, this was what created one, the sexual division of labor, and second, also this notion of a good wife and a good homemaker within the capitalist society. Wollstonecraft felt women required personhood, and hence she needed to be recognized and learned to be an end in herself. So this whole essentialization of women and as non-rational, emotional, caregiver human being was something that Wollstonecraft contested. And she said that women also need to be like men, more a rational agent whose dignity consists in having capacity for self-determination. So she needed to cultivate her mind. She needed to ensure that she knew, read, understood many different dimensions of the world outside and become equal to men. Her ideas were further expanded. Of course, her ideas were contested as well, because it was talking of a male work and male ways of looking at the role of women. But her ideas were further expanded by John Stuart Mill and Harriet Taylor. Their firm belief of women's right to vote influenced the struggle for the right of women to run for office as well and vote, and also be part of overall women's rights movements in the mid-19th century in many of the Western countries, especially in the US and Britain. In consequence, the International Women's Suffrage Alliance was created, and the European, many of the countries in Europe, US and Britain came together to demand for women's rights to vote, which was hitherto completely neglected and not considered appropriate for women. And this was being contested by what we call the liberal feminists at this point of time in history. Essentially, both Stuart Mill and Harriet Taylor believed that whilst Wollstonecraft's whole notion of rational human beings and being like men needed to be debated and discoursed, because women's realities are not all the same as men. At the same time, the fact that women were hidden and invisibilized in the public arena was a matter of discourse for them. And therefore, to ensure that women also participate in the industrial capitalist processes, they also become part of workforce, it was imperative that they also become political agents. And to become political agents, they needed that right to participate in the public arena. They needed to also ensure that they vote and also run for the political offices. So that's where they elaborated on what Wollstonecraft had laid as a foundation, even though they disagreed in the notion of women being like men. By the mid-1960s, most liberal feminists had joined, and emerging women's rights groups such as National Organization of Women, the National Women's Political Caucus, and the Women's Equity Action League, that is a WEAL, in the US. What we find is that liberal feminism actually emerged largely in the US and Britain. It was influenced by, since US was basically emerging as an industrial capitalist society, and the whole focus was on developing it into a nation where more and more the economic outcomes were more and more available for the people living there. What we find is that the liberal feminists started critiquing this this idea of only men participating in these processes, and therefore several of these organizations and women came together to form a variety of caucuses and questioning the men alone preserve in the productive work within the nation, the two nations. The basic concepts of liberal feminisms are very important for us to understand how they influence the notion of equality between men and women. Liberal feminism focuses on achievement of equality between men and women. It contends that patriarchy allows women's work in the economy in only feminine trades like nursing, teaching and childcare, and taking them away from jobs like engineering, scientific pursuits, business and technology. So liberal feminists felt that this whole notion of women being able to do only the kind of work which are extensions of their reproductive work within the household is problematic. That it is not necessary that women cannot cultivate their minds, or they cannot become engineers, or they cannot be scientists, or they cannot be equally participating in businesses and technology oriented productive work. And therefore they felt that it is important to change this kind of a mindset and discriminatory practices which limit women from moving into these so-called men alone areas and arenas. It emphasizes the power of an individual person, that is, that women are responsible and they can change these discriminatory practices. They can engage with these practices by educating their minds, accessing different informations, getting skilled, and entering different arenas and becoming more and more empowered. And when women are empowered and are able to use their abilities, they also become democratic citizens. So they bring into fore the main notion of liberal feminism is that women are equal citizens, and therefore they have the right to participate in democratic processes as equally as men, and also be equal in the eyes of the law as well as in the workplaces, whichever be the workplace where men are working. So these are some of the basic ideas with which liberal feminism has moved ahead and continues to inform various feminist movements in the world over. Another very important dimension that liberal feminism brings in, and it's very critical for us to remember, is that it emphasizes and debates the traditional understanding of human nature, personhood, rationality, individual autonomy, and self-fulfillment. It emphasizes that all individuals, in whatever condition or status or community they may belong to, they have essentially the need to strive, the need to exercise their autonomy, and the need for self-fulfillment. And therefore, women too have these possibilities, and they are able to exercise these kind of rationalities in their own ways. And therefore, sex and gender are neutral because all human beings possess a common nature. Liberal feminism also promotes the idea that a just society is one that allows individuals to exercise their freedom and fulfill themselves. And therefore, every individual has a right to do what they want and what they feel is right for themselves. And in that case, practice their own autonomy and self-determination. It emphasizes, therefore, the equality of opportunity, that all persons deserve an equal chance to develop themselves and have possibilities to develop rational thought and acquire skills and possible ways and resources to move ahead in their life and status. It also proposes that because society has a false belief that women are by nature less intellectual and physically incapable than men, it excludes women from many opportunities, and therefore women's true potential gets remains unfulfilled. And hence liberal feminism says that all such opportunities should be made available to women that are available to men in any given society or state. Women share the same kind of rational human nature as men do, and they therefore need to be given the same kind of educational opportunity and civil rights within the legal framework or state policies and programs of any country. The goal of women's liberation is freeing women from oppressive gender roles, sexual and gender equality, and promoting sexual and gender equality. Liberal feminism has led to women advancing in economic sphere and in equality of opportunity. This is very critical to remember that liberal feminist approaches have enabled women to ensure that states provide various spaces where and policies where women can equally participate in various workplaces and also develop their true potential and contribute to the economy of any given state. So liberal feminists and it has also unpacked the possibility of women to do so in a condition where women were largely relegated to the household realm. There are two types of liberal feminists at this point informs the policy programmatic interventions and engagements and movements in the ground. The classical liberal feminism believes in limited government and free market. So the propagation of the idea is that if women are given political and legal rights, and if they are given access to education and skill building, then they can anyways exercise the opportunity in the free market, and the government does not need to regulate everything within their lives, in their lives and in the society. However, welfare liberal feminists believe that this is not possible and the state has to take responsibility, because discriminatory behavior cannot be done away just by society alone or women themselves alone. It is essential that government takes a responsibility for its citizens, and hence it should take up all kinds of welfare measures which address women specific needs. For example, providing for creches, maternity benefit, timely leaves for caregiving work at home, and therefore ensure that women are equally able to participate and are also protected from backlash from their employers because they are not able to participate fully in the productive world. So welfare liberal feminists believe that market needs regulation, because market, if it is given freedom, then it will not take women into its productive labor, and it will not ensure that women's specific needs are addressed. So they need to be regulated, that's one. And the other is that the profits that markets generate, they need to be equally redistributed to marginalized sections of the society and women within these societies, because free market will largely tend to stay with its profits, and it will not believe in redistribution. So the government has a strong role to play to ensure that there are legal mechanisms and policy and programmatic interventions for the redistribution of these profits to those who are not getting these benefits. There has been a great deal of critique of the liberal feminist approach, because several of the feminists have found it very limiting and not being able to explain the diversities that exist within the world of women in the larger context and different societies. The main problem that is highlighted of liberal feminism is its tendency to accept male values as universal values. All women, therefore, are seen to actually enjoy to aspire for masculine values. So therefore, they need to work outside. They need to ensure that they work like men, is what liberal feminism propagates and is actually debated and contested by other feminists. Liberal feminism often does not take into account the analysis of class or sexuality, since it is based on the capitalist means of production, and is largely seeing free market as market as an important player in addressing economic growth and development. Liberal feminism does not include an analysis of class or sexuality within it. So the whole the different ways in which class gets propagated by capitalism, or how the bourgeoisie becomes powerful and the proletariat is left behind, and women within these two groups therefore experience discrimination and marginalization in different ways, this is something that liberal feminism really doesn't address. Alison Jagger added that men's way of seeing themselves has come to dominate the Western culture of human nature, that is of being rational. So she questions that being rational, is that the way the world should be? And is what about the nurturing and emotional role that women play? So is that not what needs to inform the ways in which cultures and development trajectories need to go ahead? So she brings in this dimension that only the male idea of rationality cannot be taken as the ways in which feminism can be practiced. As a result of this, the notion of male being the yardstick of feminist practice, all liberals, male or female, non-feminist, feminist, tend to accept as truth the priority of mental over bodily. And even when their own daily experiences contradicts this behavior, because while one says that rationality is important, the whole idea of sexuality, the whole idea of emotion, are something that's practiced every day by human beings. So how can that be invisibilized is a question that other feminists like Alison Jagger have continuously questioned, and said that this is a limiting part of the ways in which liberal feminism propagates the idea of women's empowerment and is questioned. Elstein is another one who has, another theorist who has identified what she considered liberal feminism's three major flaws. Its claim that women can become like men if they set their minds to it. And therefore invisibilize the sexual difference. Its claim that most women want to become like men is another dimension, which is a homogeneous ways, a way of looking at women, where women dispute this whole notion all the time in their own context. And thirdly, its claim that all women should want to become like men, that is to aspire to masculine values of rationality, progressiveness, and structures which actually do not allow for any kind of diversity or difference. Individual assumptions make it difficult to see ways in which underlying social structures and values disadvantage women. That is another critique of liberal feminism, that while individual freedom is important, but individual freedom is also embedded in societal dimensions and societal constructions and structures and institutions which limit women's access access various resources. And these are structural problems. These are dimensions which inhibit access to economic resources, means of production, more in terms of the socialist Marxist understanding. And therefore, this that liberal feminism is more towards individualistic assumptions is problematic, is something that is critiqued by other feminists. Even if a woman is no longer dependent on an individual man, they are still living in a patriarchal state. So for example, if men and women decide not to get married or live on their own as individuals, the state remains patriarchal. And the institutional arrangements are detrimental for women's specific needs and limit their accessibility. And therefore, how does that get unpacked and how does that change? And women's equality can only be addressed if these structural dimensions are changed or transformed. This is another disadvantage of liberal feminism, as many of the feminists would contest. The liberal feminism also ignores the dilemma of other women of different races, cultures, or classes, as it only focuses on white middle class heterosexual women is another dimension which is something that other feminists uphold and say that it is limiting in its approach. In summary, the liberal feminism can be seen as a mainstream feminist movement which focuses on individual rights and gender equality. Liberal feminism faces several criticisms, like judging women and their success by male standards. That is, for example, so if there is a woman CEO, then she is successful. But if she is a householder or homemaker, she is not really successful. So that's one of the examples of male standards, and that it is a bourgeoisie white woman's theory. However, it has contributed to ensure women's civil, educational, occupational, and reproductive rights, and therefore it's it continues to engage with the liberal thoughts and the capitalist world to ensure women's rights in different ways. So some of the references that you might want to look at are Rosemary Tong, A Comprehensive Introduction to Feminist Thought is an excellent book, and the others can be Nancy Tawana's writing and Einstein Zeda's The Radical Future of Liberal Feminism. These references can be utilized for understanding liberal feminism a little more. Thank you.